Anyone who wishes to be out on a ski tour in winter has to deal with the avalanche danger. Risk management, as it is known, is very useful here. So you have to deal with the risks and dangers. And to do this, you need some kind of structure that you can apply to the situation. For useful risk management, we recommend the DCMR method. The D stands for danger, so the probability of avalanche release. So we have to clear up the question, how probable is it that a snow slab could be triggered here on this slope? The second aspect is the consequences, the C. So what happens if a snow slab really could be released here? Where would an avalanche take you? How deep would you be buried? How serious are the consequences I can expect? The third thing I consider is the scope for action I have. So what measures I can still take either to ease the consequences or reduce the probability of an avalanche. And these three points make up the risk. So this is the risk formula that I can use to approach these dangers or these problems in winter.
In the first step of our tour planning, we want to combine the information we've taken from the avalanche bulletin with the information from the map, the information on the terrain. And the 30-degree method helps us do that. The 30-degree method helps us identify cruxes along our route. A detailed assessment is important here. What is the 30-degree method? In the 30-degree method, all of the slopes that lie along the route are analyzed. If the slope steepness is above 30 degrees and the slope is above the route or directly on the route, it is a potential crux. In the second step, we omit all of the slopes that don't correspond with the dangerous areas. So all of the slopes that have not been indicated in the avalanche bulletin as dangerous areas, essentially the slopes that are not located within the compass rows or are not a critical elevation or are not explicitly identified as dangerous areas in the avalanche bulletin, are omitted. In the second filter, we can also consider whether the avalanche bulletin indicates that we should expect spontaneous avalanches or remote triggering. If this is not the case, we can also leave out all of the slopes that are located above our route. The slopes we are left with along our route will be the basis of our risk management. And the first step in risk management, DCMR, is D. For each of these cruxes we've identified using the 30-degree method, we now assess the danger. When assessing the danger at home, when planning the tour, we have to make the best of what we've got, because the avalanche report is regional and the individual slope is local. How can we do that? We ask ourselves, is the danger on the day of our tour high or not so high? This is indicated by the danger level, the slope steepness, and other information in the danger description. If we can assume that it will probably not be very dangerous and that skier-triggered avalanches are unlikely, or that the slope steepness will be around 30 degrees, we can move our slider for danger down toward the bottom. If the danger, so the probability of an avalanche at the crux, cannot be clearly defined as more or less dangerous, we have to carry out a detailed assessment. But we'll be carrying out a detailed assessment anyway, at the very latest when we're out in the mountains.
The next thing we do after assessing the danger is look at the consequences. So what will be the consequences of a possible avalanche? Here we simply observe the terrain above and below us. In other words, the terrain is the most important factor here, so we need to study the map more closely. The four questions we have to answer when looking at the consequences start with, how big is the slope? How much slope is above me? How much slope is below me? How far will the avalanche fall? Because naturally, the fall distance of the avalanche is connected to how much snow is moving, what speed it reaches, and where it is falling to. The second point concerns the amount of snow we can expect. That is to say, how thick is the slab? How big is the slab I'll trigger? Because, of course, the consequences of a burial correlate to the amount of snow. The more snow, the deeper the burial, and the longer it will take for me to be rescued, and the lower my chances of survival. The third point I look at is whether there are any terrain traps in the avalanche track. In other words, are there any escarpments that an avalanche would drag me over or rocks that I could be crushed against? Or are there any pockets that will trap snow, so ditches that would increase my burial depth enormously? And the last thing we look at when considering the consequences is safe assembly points. The background to this is simple. If there is only one person who could potentially be caught in the avalanche, and there are quite a lot of people who could intervene, who could help, then the person's chances of survival are very good. By contrast, if, for example, I have three people who are buried, but only two helpers, then much more time will elapse before the third person is rescued, and the risk of a fatal burial increases enormously. When assessing the avalanche risk, the Is the Tour OK tool can be of help. The first thing we do, as we have learned, is look at the danger, so the probability of avalanche release, because this is extremely difficult to estimate, so whether I might initiate, whether the slab propagates. I use the slope steepness to help me, because we know that slope steepness correlates with initiation and propagation. So the steeper the slope, the more dangerous it is. I now organize the slope steepness into three danger classes, namely 30 to 35, 35 to 40, and above 40. The steeper the slope, the more dangerous it is. Finally, I ask myself what the consequences of each danger class will be. These four questions are easier to answer and link the danger with the possible consequences to provide the risk.
We said DCMR, we don't want to forget the M. M stands for measures. And this M actually comes directly after the D and the C. Because our measures relate either to the dangers, the probability of an avalanche, or to the possible consequences. A brief example, if the slope has a steepness of 30 degrees on the left and gets increasingly steeper on the right, then the measure I implement could be, for example, that I keep to the left side where it is flatter. The flatter the slope, the lower the probability of an avalanche. The measures can also relate to the possible consequences. For example, if there is a favorable assembly point on a slope, we can individually descend to this assembly point and then on from there. The benefit of this is that if something happens, only one person is in danger, and there are a lot of people who can come to their aid.
The basis of our assessment is evaluation of the danger and estimation of the consequences, which provides the risk. So we have these two blocks, probability of an avalanche and possible consequences. To keep the risk within reasonable limits, we have to visualize two sliders. If it is very dangerous, so if the probability of an avalanche is very high, then the consequences have to be very mild. So that means a mini slope with a huge fall path. And vice versa, if the possible consequences are extreme, the probability of an avalanche must drop to around zero. If both sliders are high, then the risk is obviously unacceptable. If this plan results in too high a risk, then naturally the advice is to immediately consider an alternative to these slopes, if you have identified them during planning. In other words, you can say, okay, the risk really is too high at the checkpoint, meaning the probability of an avalanche or the consequences too extreme. I want to have a plan B, so I can switch to plan B, and I'm not forced to take this risk or break off the whole tour.
DCMR is a tool used for risk management and communication and works exactly the same way we know from other areas of life, namely by estimating the probability of occurrence and the extent of the damage. When planning a tour, we take the same path we will take later out in the mountains, and we are thus perfectly prepared for the questions we will ask ourselves out on the individual slope.